Weidenfeld and Nicholson presents Supper with the Crippens, the true story of one of the most notorious murderers of all time, written and read by David James Smith. Chapter 1. On the 29th of December 1922, A.J. Wall, Secretary of the Prison Commission, Home Office, Whitehall, SW1, issued Circular Number 1027 to Pentonville Prison. The commissioners had decided that the graves of persons who had been executed in prison should no longer be distinguished by names, initials, or any other marks on the walls. "Such records are undesirable," explained Secretary Wall, "as they perpetuate the memory of the crime, cause unnecessary pain to the relatives, and rouse a morbid interest in the prisoners." It had been decided to obliterate all existing marks, but before this could be done, it was necessary to prepare records of existing graves. "The register of graves will be kept on the enclosed form, forwarded in duplicate, and the enclosed plan, a duplicate of the latter, having been retained in this office." Executions had been conducted at Pentonville since 1902, when it took over the role from Newgate Prison, which had been closed and demolished to make way for the construction of a new central criminal court at the Old Bailey. The apparatus of the scaffold, beam, cantilevered trapdoors, lever, had been transported across to Pentonville from Newgate and installed in a purpose-built facility in the exercise yard just outside B Wing, which promptly became known to all who worked or were imprisoned there as the topping shed. In later years, the scaffold will be taken into the main building of the prison and the site will be turned over to latrines, but this would not affect the small burial ground of 18 graves, which had been next to the topping shed and was separate from the main cemetery, where all the executed were buried from 1911 onwards, sometimes three deep in graves, one on top of the other, on top of the other, all in strict accordance with another detailed, albeit unnumbered, circular. Instructions to be observed in burying the bodies of executed prisoners. 1. All the clothing, with the exception of the shirt or similar garment, will be removed from the body, which will be placed in a coffin made of half-inch wood, deal, or pine. 2. The sides and ends of the coffin will be well perforated with large holes. 3. Lime will not be used. 4. The original size of the plot of ground will be 9 feet by 4 feet, and the grave will be from 8 to 10 feet in depth. 5. When the coffin has been covered with 1 foot of earth, charcoal to the depth of 3 inches will be thrown into the grave, which will then be filled in. The top coffin will not be less than 4 feet below the ground surface. 6. Arrangements will be made for the grave sites to be reused in sequence, in such wise that no grave shall be used over again until 7 years have elapsed. When a grave is reopened, the charcoal and the foot of earth above the last coffin will not be disturbed. 7. A register of graves will be kept containing the name of each convict buried, the date of burial, the site of the grave, and the position of the coffin in the grave. The last execution in 1961 of Edwin Bush, aged 21, would bring the total hanged at Pentonville to 120, comprising 112 convicted of murder and 8 others, among them R. D. Casement, 3rd of August 1916, convicted of assorted acts of treachery. They were registered in chronological order so that the small burial ground simply became the last resting place of the first 18 who were hanged in the topping shed, listed from number 1, J. MacDonald, in 1902, through to number 18, M. Collins, in 1911. Someone, perhaps a prisoner, later planted a single rose tree at this burial site, and it was transformed into a more pleasing feature of the exercise yard between B Wing and the prison hospital. The location of the rose tree became known as Crippen's Corner, and not even Circular Number 1027 could prevent this enduring association with the occupant of Plot 16. even now when the tree has long gone and the site has been covered with concrete for recent building works. There are old maps in the prison where Crippen's Corner is identified, and the name continues to be remembered by long-serving staff. Hawley Harvey Crippen has been buried there for 95 years, and there, beneath the cement, he will now remain. But he also spent 32 nights alive in the prison, in the condemned cell, on permanent execution watch from late in the afternoon of Saturday the 22nd of October 1910, when he was transferred straight to Pentonville. He had previously been held on remand at Brixton, after being convicted and sentenced to death at the Old Bailey, until 9 a.m. on the 23rd of November 1910, when the sentence was carried out. Crippen never spoke to his executioner, John Ellis, and only saw him fleetingly at the last. Ellis, who was then in his mid-30s, was every bit as meticulous in his attention to detail as those circular-writing civil servants at the prison commission. He was well known for his anxious fussing, and this was often a source of irritation to his assistant executioners, such as William Willis, who was with Ellis when he arrived at Pentonville on the eve of Crippen's execution in the late afternoon of 22nd of November, the pair having caught the first train down from Liverpool after hanging Henry Thompson, a sailor aged 54, at Walton Prison. Like Crippen, Thompson had killed his wife. Unlike Crippen, he had been too drunk to try and disguise the fact. Thompson had strangled Mary after coming home from a night's drinking. He had laid her out on the bed next to him, placed a handkerchief over her face and fallen asleep next to her. And that was how the couple were found next morning. On being asked by the judge after conviction if he had any words for the court, Thompson was reported to have replied, "No, I've got nothing to say. Sentence away and be done with it." He had apparently told friends that he had been miserable with his wife and was certain he could be no more miserable in the next world. Just before he was hanged, Thompson found out that Crippen, the more famous wife killer, was next in line for the scaffold. Thompson said, "I'll be waiting to sing for him." Then turning to the governor of Walton Prison, he added, "And I'll sing for you too when your time comes." Ellis found a crowd outside Pentonville when he arrived at around 4 p.m. Crowds had pursued the Crippen case from the beginning, gathering first outside his home, 39 Hilldrop Crescent in Camden, following the discovery there of human remains, and later at every moment of drama or potential opportunity of glimpsing the man himself or his co-accused, Ethel the Neve. Many hundreds of people had jostled on the quayside at Liverpool docks and booed and jeered the couple's return to England after their arrest in Canada back in August. Hundreds more had been waiting for them at Euston when they arrived there a few hours later on the train, and again had booed and jeered as the police steered them into waiting taxis. Another crowd had been waiting at Bow Street Police Station for a final boo and a jeer and a craning of necks when the taxis passed through the entrance. Each court appearance since had been much the same, and even now outside Pentonville, with no prospect whatsoever of seeing what was going on, the crowd stood in a quiet vigil in anticipation of tomorrow's execution. This was public theatre that had engaged a mass audience on an unprecedented scale. Ellis was already fed up with the case. He would later say that it was the only time he ever regretted being a hangman. When he was not out on execution assignments, he worked in the barber's shop he had opened on Oldham Road in Rochdale. Ever since he had been named as the man who would hang Crippen, the barbers had been crowded with customers who, it seemed to Ellis, didn't really want haircuts at all, but simply wanted to talk to him about the case or point him out. "There's the man who's going to hang Crippen." Ellis resented being endowed, as he put it, with this unpleasant notoriety, which far exceeded anything else he would experience in his career tally of 203 executions. Inside Pentonville, he proceeded with what he would call the usual formalities. He discussed the hanging with prison officials, and especially the under-sheriff, who advised on a suitable length of rope for the drop. There was a formal table of drops, which calculated and set out the appropriate length according to the weight of the condemned prisoner. The scaffold was built over a pit that was 12 feet deep to allow for the longest of drops. The pit was a handy place to park a prison van when it was not in use. The drop had to be just long enough so that Crippen's neck would be broken neatly and instantly at the bottom of the fall, but not so long that he would be decapitated, and not so short that his neck would fail to fracture and instead he would choke slowly. Crippen had been weighed that day at 142 pounds. He had put on 6 pounds since he was first admitted. The under-sheriff had recommended a drop of not less than 7 feet 6 inches, but the final word was with Ellis, and he liked to observe his subject before he made the decision. Ellis peered in through a peephole in the door of the condemned cell and saw Crippen sitting at a table writing, stopping occasionally to chat pleasantly with his two warders. Ellis was struck by his calm demeanour. He noted too that Crippen's neck appeared normal and would not require any special adjustment to the noose. Ellis spoke of men as he found them and could only say, based on his admittedly extremely limited contact, that even in the hideous clothes of a convict, Crippen had a natural amiability and innate gentlemanliness that endeared him even to his warders. He came across to Ellis as a most pleasant fellow. Only yesterday, while alone in the toilet, Crippen had broken the frame of his gold-rimmed spectacles and removed the glass lens with the apparent intention of opening a vein to avoid being hanged. Preventing suicide and ensuring that Crippen would be subjected to the full majesty of the law had been uppermost in the authorities' minds since his arrest. The Home Secretary, Winston Churchill, had issued personal instructions that Crippen should be watched constantly and not given any opportunity to evade justice. The ruse with the glasses had quickly been discovered, and there was nothing else now that Crippen could do except continue to be calm and pleasant, as everyone who ever encountered him, almost without exception, always said he was. He only cried once in the hours before his death, after being shown the final telegram from Ethel Leneve. "My living thoughts and prayers are with you. God bless you, darling." Signed, Wifey. These had long been their affectionate names for each other, Hub and Wifey. When he turned away from the peephole, Ellis decided to go 3 inches further than the under-sheriff and selected a drop of 7 feet 9 inches. He went to the scaffold and measured off the rope, then, as usual, attached the heavy sandbag to the rope, pulled the lever and dropped it as if it were a body, where it remained hanging overnight to stretch the rope ahead of the execution and ensure there would be no stretching at the actual execution, which might cause a disastrous alteration of the calculations. Both men, the murderer and his executioner, were up early on the morning of the 23rd of November. Ellis woke at 6:30 and went to check that everything was in working order. He detached the sandbag and coiled the length of rope over the beam, leaving just the noose dangling over the trap doors. He gave some thought to a change of procedure he was about to initiate, after discussing the hanging with the chief warder of Pentonville the night before. Crippen was allowed to be executed in his own clothes. He dressed in his trademark grey frock coat and a shirt, albeit with no collar. He spent some time in the chapel, alone with the warders, and the Roman Catholic prison chaplain, Thomas Carey, who was the parish priest of the nearby Church of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. Crippen had been converted to Catholicism by the wife he had killed, Belle Elmore. Neighbours often used to see them setting off for church on Sunday mornings, all dressed up. Belle had not been seen alive since the early hours of the 1st of February 1910, when she and Crippen said goodbye to their music hall friends, Paul and Clara Martinetti, as they departed by taxi following supper at 39 Hilldrop Crescent. Crippen still maintained that she was in America or somewhere. He couldn't say for sure, even though his life depended on it. Letters addressed to Churchill and others had been arriving at the Home Office in the last few days, alleging recent sightings of Belle or even claiming to have been written by Bell herself. The Home Office had not taken these very seriously. After leaving the chapel, Crippen sat down to breakfast, but did not eat much. He sat in the corner of the condemned cell with his warders and the chaplain, talking quietly. At just before 9 o'clock, the execution party gathered outside the cell door. The under-sheriff nodded, and it began, Ellis entering first with his assistant Willis just behind him. Ellis was momentarily thrown by the obstacle of some tables and chairs which he had to move to one side before he could reach Crippen. Without speaking, Crippen stood and allowed his arms to be taken by Ellis and secured behind his back with the heavy leather strap and buckle designed for that purpose. Even without his linen collar, Ellis thought Crippen appeared smart and dapper. He hadn't shaved, but still looked fresher than many condemned men Ellis had seen. Now came Ellis's change of procedure. Instead of walking to the scaffold behind the condemned man, as he always had done in the past, Ellis hurried ahead so that he was there waiting when Crippen arrived. It cut down on the shuffling and confusion that sometimes occurred on the scaffold. No doubt the chief warder, who had suggested it, was trying to hasten the end of the ordeal and reduce the suffering of Crippen, and maybe that of everyone else in attendance too. Ellis watched the procession come towards him from a short distance, just under 40 feet. The priest led the way, praying. Ellis saw a smile on Crippen's face then, and it was still there when Ellis placed the white hood over his head while his assistant buckled Crippen's legs together with the other leather strap. They stepped back. Ellis threw the lever and the trapdoors fell open, and Crippen dropped. Thud! As Ellis would describe it, exclamation mark and all, in his memoirs, under the chapter heading, Dr. Crippen dies with a smile. By Ellis's proud calculations, it was exactly 1 minute from the moment he first entered the cell until Crippen was killed. His constant aim was to try and smooth the process and reduce the time. In accordance with the regulations for the conduct of executions, Crippen was left hanging for precisely 1 hour, after which he was lowered and a post-mortem carried out in the nearby prison mortuary. The doctor was unhappy with the extent of the damage to Crippen's neck and, blaming it on the excessive drop, complained to Ellis, who shrugged and said that so far as he was concerned, it was a good thing as it confirmed that Crippen had died instantly. The doctor made an oblique note of his displeasure in the logbook record of an execution which was kept at the prison in the governor's office. In the box headed Approximate Statement of the Character and Amount of Destruction to the Soft and Bony Structures of the Neck, he wrote, No destruction of soft parts. Cervical vertebrae about third was broken and distinct interval between bony structure. His comments hinted at an excess of breaks and excessive stretching of the neck, a clear criticism of the executioner. Ellis had no time to dwell on such details. Not right now, anyway. He said he was never troubled by the nature of his work. He had another train to catch for an appointment the next morning at Reading Jail with William Broom, aged 26, who had suffocated an elderly woman in Slough. He was pleased with the effectiveness of his new procedure and had already resolved to adopt it at all his future executions. It must have been much later, following his retirement, that John Ellis stopped to reflect. He first attempted suicide. He tried to shoot himself, but missed and was slightly injured instead. In 1924, just a few months after his last execution. It was against the law to kill yourself in those days, and Ellis was brought before Rochdale magistrates, where the chairman of the bench said, I am very sorry to see you here, Ellis. If your aim had been as straight as the drops you have given, it would have been a bad job for you. The case was reported in the newspapers and seen by Tom Pierpoint of that well-known dynasty of executioners, who said to his nephew, Albert, Bloody hell, Ellis has tried to commit suicide. He should have done it years ago. It was impossible to work with him. Ellis evidently suffered from undiagnosed depression for most of the rest of his life. Until early one Tuesday evening in September 1932, he chased his wife and daughter from his home with a cutthroat razor, shouting, I'll cut your heads off, and then stood at the front door and drew the razor across his own throat twice after which he collapsed and died. As he left Pentonville en route to Reading, Ellis passed the bigger crowd which was now gathered, admiring their resilience on such a cold, foggy morning. He knew that they had even been denied the usual tolling of a bell to confirm that an execution had been carried out. The bell had been silenced as a courtesy to the three other men who were awaiting execution at the prison. In the event, two would be reprieved and only Noah Wolfe would be hanged by the Ellis-Willis team on the 21st of December. He was 58 and had stabbed another man at a home for the elderly in Upper Holloway. Still, the crowd was satisfied eventually by the appearance of a notice of execution on the prison gates. Perhaps it was a copy of the notice which the governor, Major Mitten Davis, was obliged, under Standing Order No. 577, to forward to the prison commissioners, confirming that the execution had taken place. Gentlemen, I have the honour to submit. A short inquest was held at 2 p.m. the same day before a jury inside the prison's visiting committee rooms. The coroner was Walter Schroeder, who had some weeks earlier conducted the inquest into the death of Crippen's wife, in which that jury had returned a verdict of willful murder against him. The sole witness was the doctor, the prison surgeon, Mr. J.H.P. Wilson. Coroner. There was no resistance? Doctor. None at all, not the least. Coroner. Nor any struggle? Doctor. None. Nor was there any delay in carrying out the sentence. It took exactly 60 seconds from the time the executioners entered the condemned cell until the time of death. Coroner. Was death instantaneous? Doctor. Absolutely. There was a drop of 7 feet 9 inches. I have examined the body since the execution and find a fracture of the vertebrae, an absolute fracture right through. The jury then found that the deceased was Hawley Harvey Crippen and that he had been executed properly according to law. Jury foreman, may I ask the governor of the prison if there has been a confession? Coroner, that is not a question which concerns us. It may not have concerned the inquest, but the question was the latest turn in public fascination with the story, after publication the previous evening of an alleged full confession by Crippen in a new and destined to be short-lived London daily, the Evening Times. There will be another in that week's edition of the magazine John Bull, which would really incense the Home Office, its editor, after all, was a Member of Parliament, and get Crippen's solicitor, a flagrant opportunist named Arthur Newton, into serious trouble with the Law Society. The Crippen case, as he had shrewdly seen from the start, had been rich pickings for Newton, in collusion with the press, but it would be his professional undoing too. Even by today's standards of intrigue, deception and financial shenanigans in the print media, the conduct of the newspapers in pursuing Crippen and Neve had been rapacious. The wheelings and dealings continued unabated as his body was being stripped down to its shirt and the coffin vented and readied for Plot 16. Lofty editorials in the Times could not loosen Crippen's grip on the imagination of post-Edwardian England, and the trail of mysteries was far from complete. Much of the story will be hidden away in Home Office files and old police records for years to come, and given the dearth of reliable information, a number of myths and misrepresentations would arise and be perpetuated in a succession of studies of the case. It would, for example, become romantic fact that Crippen had been buried with Leneve's photograph and letters, and that Leneve herself, depicted everywhere unbelievably as an innocent young woman who always told the truth, had disappeared that very day or the next on a boat to the Americas, disguised as a Miss Allen, and not returned to England for 4 or even 6 years. She would later supposedly turn up in the 1930s, living in poverty in Perth, Australia. Another fact, enshrined by the officer himself in repeated telling, maintained that it was Chief Inspector Dew, wielding a poker by his own hand, who first uncovered the loose bricks in the floor that led to the discovery of the remains in the coal cellar of Crippen's home. None of these various facts, it turns out, and many more beside them, are quite true, and with some diligent research and access to papers now released into the public archive, it has been possible to create a completely new account of the Crippen case, which bears close resemblance to what actually happened that year and afterwards. One Tuesday in July 1910, Mrs. Clara Martinetti left the apartment she shared in the West End with her husband and took a familiar journey to their weekend home by the River Thames at Penton Hook, Staines, which they called Clariscio Bungalow. The police had been asking more questions about that last meal at 39 Hilldrop Crescent. She had done her best to answer them, but had realised afterwards that there was more to tell and decided to put something on paper directly to Chief Inspector Dew. Clara apologised for writing in longhand with a pencil, and although the original has not survived, it was dutifully typed up by the police and retained in their files and eventually passed, apparently unnoticed, into the public domain, in a box at the public records office. "I thought," she wrote, "that I'd better write down to you the whole story from the beginning." That was the night of the 31st of January 1910, the night Bell disappeared, the story of Supper with the Crippens. Chapter 2. No one could later recall anything unusual about Crippen's behaviour the next day, Tuesday the 1st of February 1910. Even though it seemed certain that he must have gone to work in the morning, more or less as usual, leaving his wife's corpse at home after killing her some hours earlier, once the Martinettis had left. The date had already acquired a significance for Crippen, possibly not unrelated to the crime, as the day he was to be replaced as the manager of Munyon's Homeopathic Remedy Company, for whom he had begun work 15 years earlier, while still in the United States. He had come to England to launch the London office over a decade ago, but his relationship with the firm had changed over the years, as he had fallen in and out of favour with its founder, James Munro Munyon, Professor Munyon, as he preferred to be known. Crippen's business affairs and various medical endeavours were complex, and even though he had just finished at Munyon's, he still went to the same suite of offices to work, having begun a partnership there with a young New Zealand dentist, Dr. Gilbert Rylance, known as Crippen and Rylance Artificial Teeth Manufacturers, and also as Yale Tooth Specialists. At about midday, he must have left the offices, rooms 57 to 61, on the third floor of Albion House, New Oxford Street, and walked the short distance to the Martinetti's mansion block at the top of Shaftesbury Avenue. Clara answered the door and welcomed him in. Crippen said he'd come to see how Paul was. Clara's husband had an ongoing illness and had become unwell the night before during supper. Clara told Crippen she had rubbed Paul's chest when they got home the previous night and had given him a hot drink. That tenderness between a husband and wife was in sharp contrast to what must have been going on at 39 Hilldrop Crescent. "If you don't mind, Peter," said Clara, "Paul is fast asleep just now and I don't care to wake him up." Crippen was known to his wife and all their mutual friends, for no obvious reason, as Peter. Perhaps his wife had taken against the name Hawley and the name Harvey. He waved his hand and said, "No, no. Don't wake him up. I'm glad he is not worse." Crippen turned to leave the apartment, and Clara opened the door to let him out. "And how is Belle?" she asked as he was going. "Oh, she is all right," Crippen replied. "Give her my love, will you?" "Yes, I will." There was no mention of Belle going away. Clara would have expected to see Belle the next day at the regular Wednesday afternoon meetings of the Music Hall Ladies' Guild. Both Clara and Belle were on the committee, and it was Belle who had introduced Clara to the guild 18 months before, soon after they had met. Belle had just become the guild's honorary treasurer and was already trusted and admired as a hard-working fundraiser. The guild had been formed to support the poorer women and children of the music hall profession. It was still a relatively new organization and keen to promote its activities in the trade papers, such as the Music Hall and Theatre Review. "Friends of the charity are heartily welcome to tea and reception held every Wednesday 4 to 5 o'clock. Funds, boots and clothing are urgently needed," Secretary Melinda May. The receptions evidently followed the committee meetings at which the business of the week was conducted. The Guild was based in room 63 at Albion House, right next door to Crippen's Enterprises. Bell must have recommended the location. All the committee knew Peter anyway. They shared a social life together, his calm and quiet manner a foil to Bell's extravagant personality. They liked and respected him as the perfect, if not the most attractive, husband, and could see no cracks in the surface of the Crippen's marriage. Obviously, they had missed the fact that he was having an affair with his secretary. According to Ethel Leneve, she found the letters on her desk when she arrived for work on the morning of Wednesday, the 2nd of February. Leneve's role in Crippen's life was ambiguous in all ways at this stage. She would call herself his private secretary, that indispensable functionary who was fast becoming a symbol of the metropolitan age amid the rise of the new secretarial class. In the chilly descriptions of others around them who were less enamoured of her than Crippen, she was variously the typist, the little typist, the lady typist, or the typewriter, as she had been when she first met Crippen around 1901. When Leneve sold her story to the papers just before the execution, she presented a self-serving narrative of her life with Crippen. There were many lies, but there is no reason to suppose this part of it is anything but true. In any case, it's all there is of her other than a brief police statement. She never gave evidence in court, and never talked or gave interviews other than this one serialization in Lloyd's Weekly News, which was published soon afterwards as a short book. What she knew and when she knew it is the critical issue to keep in mind as events progress. There was, she said, a note with the letters, a note from Crippen that was addressed to her. Belle Elmore has gone to America. Will you kindly favour me by handing the enclosed packet and letters to Miss May as soon as she arrives at her office with my compliments? She'll be in later when we can arrange a pleasant little evening. Of Crippen himself, there was no sign. Leneve says she assumed he had gone to his other business at Craven House on Kingsway, the new thoroughfare running south of Holborn, not far from Albion House. Maybe he was at Craven House, or maybe, as the rest of the Guild Committee gathered that Wednesday afternoon, he was at home working on the disposal of his wife's body. Melinda May had no sooner arrived at the Guild's offices just before 1 o'clock than Leneve appeared at the door. "I think these are yours," she said. The packet contained the Guild's passbook and paying-in book, which Bell had held as treasurer. There was one letter addressed to the committee and one to Melinda May herself. Both letters were written in longhand by Crippen. Both were signed in Bell's name, in Crippen's hand, but the letter to Miss May at least acknowledged the deceit with a PPHHC. 39 Hilldrop Crescent North, February 2nd, 1910. "Dear Miss May, illness of a near relative has called me to America on only a few hours' notice, so I must ask you to bring my resignation as a treasurer before the meeting today, so that a new treasurer can be elected at once. You will appreciate my haste when I tell you I have not been to bed all night, packing and getting ready to go. I shall hope to see you again a few months later, but cannot spare a moment to call on you before I go. I wish you everything nice until I return to London again. And now goodbye. With love, hastily. Yours, Belle Elmore, PPHHC." Melinda May was not one of Belle's intimates, but they were friends, and she had spent New Year's Eve at 39 Hilldrop Crescent only a few weeks earlier. It was a small gathering, just her and Lil Hawthorne and her husband John Nash. Hawthorne, who was also on the Guild Committee, was a celebrated music hall performer with popular songs such as Rosie O'Grady and I'll Be Your Sweetheart, and her current favourite, Tell Me If You Love Me. Hawthorne's husband was also her manager, and they may have been drawn to the Crippens because they too were expatriate Americans. Like a number of other performers of the Crippens' acquaintance, the Martinettis among them, Lil had left American vaudeville to take advantage of the huge audience for music hall in Britain since the turn of the century. returning sometimes to undertake American tours. There were 48 music halls in London alone, with a total capacity for 70,000 people, which could be doubled by twice nightly performances at most venues. There were dozens more halls throughout the provinces and hundreds of performers at work to fill the bills, since most turns only lasted for a maximum of 10 or 15 minutes, just long enough for two or three songs, a few well-rehearsed jokes or a sketch. The terms of appearance were strictly controlled by the hall owners, and the overwhelming majority of performers earned very little. They did not travel around in chauffeured cars. Melinda May had not planned to go out that night to see the old year out and the new year in, and had excused herself to Belle on the grounds that she was untidy. But Belle had evidently ignored her. The Nashes called at Melinda May's on the way to Camden and made her come. So May had travelled there and back in style in Lil Hawthorne's own car. The Crippens were certainly moving in exalted circles at this time. Their three guests had arrived early, about 11 o'clock, and Belle had gone downstairs to the kitchen to make American cocktails. At midnight, the front door was opened and they gathered at the top of the stone steps, listening to the hooting of sirens, the ringing of church bells, the hammering of trays, and the rest of what May would call the strangely moving noises that were made by those who marked the last new year of the Edwardian age. Belle handed round the cocktails and, true to May's impression of her large-hearted nature, offered a drink to Lil's chauffeur and a passing police constable, who both accepted. They had then gone down to the basement parlour next to the kitchen for supper, and May and the Nashes had finally left at about 1:30 in the morning, a time neighbours would often associate later with the noise of departure of the Crippens' supper guests. May read the second letter from Belle, which was addressed to the committee. Crippen had obviously tried to cover all the angles. 39 Hilldrop Crescent, London North, to the committee of the Music Hall Ladies Guild. Dear friends, please forgive me a hasty letter and any inconvenience I may cause you, but I have just had news of the illness of a near relative, and at only a few hours' notice I am obliged to go to America. Under the circumstances, I cannot return for several months, and therefore beg you to accept this as a formal letter resigning from this date my honorary treasurership of the Music Hall Ladies Guild. I am enclosing the checkbook and deposit book for the immediate use of my successor, and to save any delay, I beg to suggest that you vote to suspend the usual rules of election and elect today a new honorary treasurer. I hope some months later to be with you again, and in the meantime wish the Guild every success and ask my good friends and pals to accept my sincere and loving wishes for their own personal welfare. Believe me, yours faithfully, Belle Elmore. The committee were puzzled. Belle was good at keeping in touch, and it was unlike her not to have spoken to at least one of them directly. But they were not immediately suspicious. They expected to hear from her soon, and agreed under the guidance of the Guild President, Louise Smithson, to appoint a temporary treasurer, Lottie Albert, who would still be treasurer more than 20 years later, and write a letter to Belle saying they would keep the post open for her until she returned. Lil Hawthorne was playing the Tottenham Empire that week and so missed the meeting and only got half the story, hearing that Belle had resigned, but not that she had supposedly gone abroad. She asked her husband manager to send a wire to Belle at home, saying they would visit her on Saturday. Lil hoped to persuade Belle to withdraw her resignation. The Guild never received a reply to their letter, and when the Nashes called round 3 days later, the house was shut up and in darkness, and there was no answer at the door. Her resignation was a blow to the committee. The previous September, Belle had been honoured during the Guild's second annual dinner, held at the Hotel de Boulogne restaurant on Gerrard Street in Fitzrovia. She must have been proud of the write-up afterwards in the trade paper, The Era, which took up an entire column. Of the dozens who had been there, among them many of the best-known performers on the halls, the name of Belle Elmore was listed first in The Era as among those present. The Era recorded the outgoing president, Mrs. Fred Jeanette. She was really Isabel, but women were referred to by their husband's name in those days. as making a speech saying how subscriptions had doubled in the last year. She had gone on to thank the Guild's medical officers, Dr. Burrows and Dr. Walker, who had during the past 5 weeks dealt with as many as 7 maternity cases, all of which had been carried out successfully and comfortably. Bell had read out the donations from such elevated characters as Sir Herbert Beerbohm Tree, the dramatic actor, 1 guinea, and Mr. George Formby, the ukulele player, 10 shillings. There were many others, including 6 shillings from Mrs. Doust of the Tally Ho Trio. After this, there had been a special presentation to Bell, amid great enthusiasm, the era reported, of a handsome illuminated address and a gold bangle. Bell did love her jewellery, and a basket of flowers and a box of gloves. The bangle had been inscribed, "To the Hustler." Bell had spoken in reply, and her speech was reported apparently in full. They were almost her only recorded words outside those conversations that people who had known her remembered later. "I do not know how to thank you for this beautiful present. In fact, I don't think I really deserve it. I never anticipated anything of this sort. The work I've done for the Guild, I have done because I really loved doing it, and my reward was that we were always pretty successful. However, knowing this lovely compliment is paid to me in appreciation of my work for the Guild, I can only say that as long as I am permitted, I will do in the future as I have done in the past. And as we all learn by experience, I hope to improve upon the work I have done and further the interests of the Guild to the best of my ability." They did not sound like the words of a woman who was about to cut and run. In Ethel's version of that Wednesday, the 2nd of February, she saw Crippen for the first time at around 4 p.m. "Luneve, I have had your note. Has Belle Elmore really gone away?" Crippen: "Yes, she has left me." Luneve: "Did you see her go?" Crippen: "No, I found her gone when I got home last night." Luneve: "Do you think she will come back?" Crippen: "No, I don't." Luneve: "Did she take any luggage with her?" Crippen: "I don't know what luggage she had because I did not see her go. I dare say she took what was wanted. She always said that the things I gave her were not good enough, so I suppose she thinks she can get better elsewhere." Ethel wrote, or told, the 2 ghosting journalists who wrote it for her, and according to them, believed her every word. "I was, of course, immensely excited at this disappearance of Dr. Crippen's mysterious wife. But at the same time, it did not altogether surprise me. I knew well enough that they had been on bad terms together. I knew she had often threatened to go away and leave him." This will be Crippen's version of his life with Belle, too, in his statement to the police and at his trial. He would say she was always threatening to leave him. Surprisingly, Crippen's account of Belle's character would take hold and become the basis for all the traducing of Belle that would occur later, in which the natural conclusion seemed to be that she deserved what she got, and it was a wonder he hadn't killed her sooner. In her desperate attempts to demonstrate her innocence even after she had been acquitted at her own trial, Ethel wanted to show that Crippen was lying to her too, and she knew nothing of what had really happened. Obviously, there was no luggage missing from the house, and Crippen well knew that Belle had not gone away. It's possible, even probable, that Ethel well knew that too. It's possible that the conversation was completely invented. "Next," said Ethel, Crippen produced a handful of jewels from his pocket. Crippen: "Look here, you had better have these. At all events, I wish you would please me by taking 1 or 2. These are good, and I should like to know you had some good jewellery." Luneve: "Well, if you really wish it, I will have 1 or 2. Pick out which you like." Crippen selected a couple of solitaire rings, a ring set with 4 diamonds, and a ruby and a small diamond brooch. That brooch was destined to become a famous emblem in the case. It was a sunburst design, or, as the Lord Chief Justice would describe it to the jury at Crippen's trial, "It is a sort of star, gentlemen, with apparent brilliance." There was to be a second alternative story of Ethel's acquisition of that brooch. For now, Ethel said that there was still a lot of jewellery left over from the handful. A very large brooch set with beautiful stones in the shape of a tiara, with many rows of diamonds arranged in a crescent, and half a dozen fine rings. She wanted us, her readership, to know that Crippen was a real expert in diamonds and often used to show her how to tell their relative values by holding them up to the light and observing their colour. Here was Crippen, the older, cultured tutor of the unworldly young woman. As a result, I got to know the different fashions of setting and could distinguish between those set in London and New York. And finally, we get to the point of the story, which is to explain how it was that Crippen came to pawn his wife's baubles 2 days after her disappearance. One of the more incriminating acts against him, and which he would lie about to the police. I then asked what he would do with the remainder, as it would not do to leave them about in the house, and as we had no safe. No safe, not true, there was a safe. It would surely be better either to sell them or to pawn them. Perhaps the latter course would be best, as he could redeem them whenever he was disposed to do so. To which Crippen, of course, replied, "That is a good idea. I will take your advice." Well, perhaps it really did happen like this, and it was this exchange with Neve that propelled Crippen to Attenborough's pawnbroker's at 142 Oxford Street on Wednesday the 2nd of February. Though he must have been pushed for time if he went this late, since by now it would have been well after 4 o'clock and the shops usually closed around 5. In any event, it is a matter of record that Attenborough's paid £80 to Crippen for just 2 items, described as a brilliant marquise ring and a pair of single stone earrings. He was back there 7 days later with a brilliant brooch and 6 brilliant rings, one with a stone defect, in return for which he was given a further £115. £1 in 1910 would be worth approximately £63 today. He would say that he invested the money in his businesses, but there will be no trace of where it went. At his trial, the Crown would argue that he was short of funds and that this was a motive in his killing of his wife. It is hard to divine the truth about his finances, even though all the records are available. There is evidence for and against him being broke. He was certainly £2.13.11 overdrawn at the bank on the day his wife died, though funds were paid in later to bring it back to a credit balance. He applied for and was granted a £20 overdraft facility on the 1st of February, but of course he never needed it because he had the proceeds of the pawnings instead. And there was £600 on deposit at the bank, albeit only redeemable after 12 months' notice. For some reason, unfathomably, Crippen will blurt out at his trial that Ethel Leneve had slept the night at 39 Hilldrop Crescent for the first time on Wednesday, the 2nd of February. She would say that her first night came some days later. In court and elsewhere, and this may be why he said it, the admission would be used as an argument against his having killed Bell. How could anyone be so callous as to bring their lover to the scene of the crime so soon after the crime? But the real question is, how did she manage not to notice the corpse or traces of it if she really was there? Remarkably, this statement of Crippen's was not used against Ethel at her trial. So many things, her frequent lies especially, were not used against her. If she was there that night, she must have known what had happened. She must have been in on the murder, either before or immediately after it happened. By her own account, Ethel did not go into the house until 3 or 4 days later. Although she had called there occasionally on business during Bell's lifetime, she only went beyond the front door for the first time after Crippen had said he would like to take her to the theatre that evening, but was worried about the animals at home, which he had forgotten to feed that morning. There were various animals, which had mostly been Bell's. Sometimes, of course, domestic pets can be substitutes for children. Bell could not conceive following an ovariotomy some years earlier. There were 7 canaries in a cage, possibly some other birds, at least 2 cats, one a luscious white Persian, and a bull terrier, of which, said Ethel Crippen, was especially fond. Ethel volunteered to go to Camden and feed the menagerie. Crippen gave her the key and she let herself in by the side door. Front doors were rarely used then by those fortunate enough to have an alternate means of entry, except on special occasions. She went into the kitchen and then down to the pantry to fetch some milk. The pantry was next to the coal cellar. As she did this, the Persian cat escaped from the kitchen and she had to chase it all round the house, she says, thus emphasising that she went in all the rooms. She was worried because there was a valuable bird in the front room which the cat might have eaten, and Crippen had told her to keep the cats in the kitchen in case they soiled the upstairs carpet. She eventually caught the Persian and returned it to the kitchen. She had seen the whole house. If a murder had recently been committed, there were certainly no traces of it, she wrote. We are not told what play, if any, she saw that evening. Throughout February, Crippen was digging himself in deeper with the various members of the guild who asked after Bell at every opportunity, apparently forcing him to invent or embellish his story on the hoof. He did not seem averse to drawing attention to it either. Have you noticed how lonely I am? He asked his dental partner, Dr. Rylance, a day or two after Bell's disappearance. Evidently, Rylance had not noticed. Crippen said his wife was halfway to America, gone on legal business to settle estates after his mother's death, though his mother had died some time earlier. When he next called at the Martinettis on the 7th of February, Clara scolded him. Well, you're a nice one. Bell already gone to America and you don't let us know anything about it. Why did you not send us a wire? I would have liked to go to the station and bring some flowers. There had been no time, said Crippen. The cable had come late on Tuesday night, the night of the 1st of February, which meant that one of them had to go. As Bell had wanted to go, he let her. He then had to look out some papers, and they spent the rest of the night packing. Clara, packing and crying, I suppose. Crippen, oh, we have got past that. Clara, did she take all her clothes with her? Crippen, one basket. Clara, that won't be enough, one basket, to go all that way. Crippen, she can buy something more over there. Clara, oh, she is sure to send me a postcard from the ship. Crippen nodded. Paul asked what it was that she had gone over for in such a hurry. Crippen said it was on important business for him, important legal business. In fact, there was a title attached to it, but he wouldn't use it. This, I think, meant title deed to a property rather than title as in duke or lord. By the time they met again a week later, Crippen was already laying the foundations for his future story. He told the Martinettis he had heard that Bell had become rather ill and had something wrong with her lungs. Her lungs? Clara hadn't known there was a problem with Bell's lungs. She couldn't understand why Bell hadn't written. Crippen said he didn't know why. Clara said she thought Bell was going via New York and would see the old guild president, Mrs. Jeanette, who was staying with relatives there while her husband, Fred Jeanette, was on tour. They too were Americans who had settled in London. Fred Jeanette, a former circus owner, had transferred to the halls with an equestrian act and had become famous for his sketches, including his on-stage recreation of Dick Turpin's ride to York. His wife, Isabel, had trained the horses he used. They were among the aristocracy of show business. Fred had been King Rat of the Grand Order of Water Rats, the theatrical charity, in 1909. Paul Martinetti was a former King Rat, too. Oh no, said Crippen. Bell would not be seeing Mrs. Jeanette. She wasn't touching New York. She was going straight on to California. Crippen's family, such as it was, now lived in California. New York was clearly tricky and had to be kept out of the story. Melinda May asked Crippen what she should do about Bell's guild subscription, which was due. Could she write to her? No, said Crippen. She was up in the hills of California. But he would forward a letter for her if she wished. He again saw the Martinettis and was asked and again had to say that he had still not heard from Bell. Clara asked him if he was going to the Ladies' Guild Ball which was coming up. He and Bell would have been certain guests. Crippen said no, he didn't think so. Clara must have encouraged him. Paul could get him tickets from the club, she said. They were half a guinea each. All right, said Crippen. He would take two. The ball was held on the 20th of February at the glamorous and ornate Criterion restaurant on Piccadilly Circus. Crippen took Ethel, Neve, and joined the Martinetti's table, Crippen sitting with Clara on one side and Ethel on the other. Clara recalled that she merely nodded at Ethel, but never spoke to her. Opposite them were Lil Hawthorne and John Nash. Louise Smithson was there too. They all saw the brooch Ethel was wearing, the sunburst brooch, which Clara described as a centre diamond with pearls radiating from it in a zigzag pattern all the way round. It was, they all knew, Belle's brooch. Ethel was wearing a pink dress, and there were those who thought it was Belle's dress she was wearing too. Crippen and his typist? Well, well, what was going on? Mrs. Smithson asked Crippen for Belle's address. Had he heard from her? Oh yes, he said. She was right up in the wilds of the mountains in California. Louise asked him to let her know when he got some news of her. Crippen said that he would tell her as soon as Belle had a settled address. John Nash could not help noticing that Crippen and the girl were drinking freely of the wine. It was his wife who pointed out the brooch to him. Ethel must have been stung by the remarks about her when all this came out later. She took the opportunity of telling her life story to set the record straight. Neither she nor Crippen had been keen to go to the ball, she said. She had not danced in years and had nothing to wear. Belle's clothes would not have fitted her. They were different sizes, clearly. Ethel had gone to Swan and Edgar's, just across Piccadilly Circus from the Criterion, and they had made the pink dress for her. Perhaps poignantly, the lie betraying a wish for a different kind of life. Belle's life, maybe. Ethel, who was still in lodgings at Hampstead at this stage, told her landlady, Mrs. Jackson, that she would not be home the night before the ball. She was going to stay at the Martinettis, and Mrs. Martinetti was going to do Ethel's hair for her, especially for the occasion. Chapter 3. Crippen married Belle Elmore on the 1st of September 1892 at St. Paul's Church, Jersey City. She gave her age as 19. He was, it is stated, 30 years and 2 months. This is one of the few fixed dates in Crippen's past, and there is limited information about his early history. Most of what is known is based on his own account in his statement to the police and in evidence at his trial, so must be treated with caution, except where there is corroboration. He seems to have had a terrible memory for dates. As does Belle, she was actually born on the 3rd of September 1873, making her just 18 at the time of her marriage. Another fixed point is the death of Crippen's first wife, whose maiden name was Charlotte Jane Belle, on the 24th of January 1892 in Salt Lake City, Utah. So Crippen had returned to the East Coast and met and married Belle in the space of a little over 7 months. Not that Belle was going by that name in those days. Belle Elmore was an affectation she took to later in England, perhaps styling herself after, or even blatantly stealing from, Mary Lloyd, the greatest music hall singer of the age, who began her career as Bella Delmere, or possibly Belle or Delmore, Delamere or Delmar. Different sources gave different versions of the name. She might have hoped that some of Marie Stardust would fall on her. If so, she was out of luck. According to Crippen, he met Belle in New York after going to work as an assistant to a Dr. Jeffrey in Brooklyn. Jeffrey seems to have been a conventional general practitioner. Belle was a patient, though we do not know what her complaint was. Perhaps it was connected to the operation she had not long afterwards. Crippen said she had told him she was going by the name of Cora Turner. She had been living with a stove manufacturer named C.C. Lincoln, but he had given up the house they were sharing, and she was now living alone in a room Lincoln had rented for her, all expenses paid. As Crippen put it, she was living under the protection of Lincoln. Crippen and Cora started going around together. He took her to several places and became very fond of her. When Cora told Crippen that Lincoln wanted her to go away with him, Crippen said he could not stand that and would marry her right away, which he did a few days later, no doubt just as Cora had intended he would. Crippen says the wedding was held at a minister's house in Jersey City. The official record places it at the church, with Cora giving her name as Corinne Connie Turner, the daughter of Joseph Turner and Mary Wolfe. "It was only after they were married," said Crippen, "that Cora told him the name Turner was a fiction. In fact, she was the daughter of Joseph Makamotsky." The spelling of this is by no means certain. It is sometimes written as Makamatsky, and her given name was Kunigunde. Cora told Crippen that her father was a Russian Pole and her mother was German. In London, some years later, during a conversation with a friend about actresses marrying titled men, Belle would produce a cutting from an American newspaper which she seemed to carry around, folded in her bag. "You won't believe I have a title," she would say, showing the article, which was about a woman with a name like Motsky, who was a baroness or maybe a countess entitled to some property in Russia. Belle said the article was about her. This must have been as fanciful as the name Turner. There was no real evidence of any title, and Joe Makamotsky seems to have been a typical poor Eastern European immigrant to the New World. There were two children by the time of his death, Cora and a younger sister, Teresa. Their mother, Mary, then married a Brooklyn farmer. You won't find many of those in Brooklyn these days, called Frederick Merzinger. And there was a stepsister, Louise. Mary died before her daughter's murder. Cora evidently did not invite her family to her wedding. Instead, they met Crippen for the first time a day or two later, when he was presented to them in Brooklyn as her husband. Not long after this, Crippen went to work in Philadelphia and settled there briefly with his wife. From Philadelphia, Cora, still barely 20, wrote and told her mother she was to undergo an operation. Her mother visited her in hospital and later told Cora's sister, Teresa, that Cora's womb and her ovaries had been removed and she would never have children. Later, when it was a matter of life and death for Crippen, Teresa would recall Cora showing her the scar from that operation, still fresh and livid. The aftermath of the operation was problematic and seems to have been a talking point with Belle for the rest of her life. Friends would recall being shown the scar or hearing about it, about the discharge that had resulted and about the pus bag that had formed over it for a while. In the old police files, there is an anonymous letter from 1910 which seeks to confirm the details of the operation, that it took place at the Hahnemann Hospital at Broad and Vine Streets in Philadelphia in, so far as the anonymous writer can recall, 1893 or 1894. The letter writer had visited Belle in the hospital where she was a private patient, and Belle had said her ovaries had been.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.